I'm Mort Cooper, your host on Change Your Voice, Change Your Life. In studio with me is Dr. John Curtis, my co-host, and we're talking about voice insanity. What does that mean to you or to anybody else? Dr. Curtis, you came up with the title. What's the definition?
Well, you know, the whole voice field is just seems insane right now, because mm-hmm. your view of the field is diametrically opposed to the entire medical establishment. Mm-hmm. And I think what is so fascinating about it is that you are the only one presenting cures of this dreadful condition, spasmodic dysphonia, mm-hmm. in the entire world, not just in Los Angeles, mm-hmm. not the United States, but on the entire planet. You mm-hmm. are the only one that is offering cures, and yet the medical establishment says that cures don't exist.
Does that intrigue you?
I think it's fascinating, especially given that medicine is supposed to provide patients with up-to-the-minute treatment and the best cures, mm-hmm. the most expedient treatments. Mm-hmm. What could be more expedient than an injection or a surgery or something like that? I understand that you get results with people in sometimes seconds, mm-hmm. minutes.
Well, I don't get results. What I can do very quickly is find their real voice. The medical community says that the condition, the strangled voice, spasmodic dysphonia, is the strangled, strained voice. You hear it on people like Robert Kennedy Jr., Diane Rehm of NPR. This is strangled. It's a strain in the lower throat, and the medics are saying it's a dystonia, which means it's a neurological problem, and you can't change it. So what I'm doing is showing the patients and the people in my field, having presented over the years, the American Speech and Hearing Association, 1974, 1979, and the year 2000, for 3 hours, showing them how I find cures of spasmodic yeah. dysphonia by changing from the lower throat to the face, because all strangled voices in the lower throat, the medical community and I agree on that, but they're saying it's a dystonia, which means neurological, and I can't do it. I do it repetitively, and it's relatively simple to do. But then it takes time to secure a carryover to
yeah.
a cure.
What's interesting about it, the notion of insanity, mm-hmm. you know, we're talking about voice insanity, mm-hmm. is to some extent a consensus. Mm-hmm. That is, you have to have like an agreement of a large body of opinion. Mm-hmm. Like the large body of medical opinion and pharmaceutical opinion today believes that this condition that you're talking about, where the voice is strangled, mm-hmm. even these strained voices, mm-hmm. are really due to reflux.
No.
Now, what's your take on that? You've been watching these patients. You've been mm-hmm. seeing them go to their ENT doctors. Do they have reflux, many of these patients?
Yesterday I saw a young man. He had a terrible voice. And he's been on reflux drugs for some time, and a period of years. He's been switched from one reflux drug to another because the ear, nose, and throat doctor believes one may not be sufficient, another may be the answer. He was so bad that he finally came in because he needed help, and he wasn't getting it from the medical help or the speech pathologist.
So he didn't find that the reflux drugs improved his voice, because isn't the medical theory that regurgitation of gastric contents that mm-hmm. include pepsin and hydrochloric acid somehow mm-hmm. leak into the vocal cords, creating this raspiness or strain in the voice?
Yeah.
What's interesting about that is that after taking the reflux drugs, which is designed to neutralize any of that acid, mm-hmm. You're suggesting that there isn't a corresponding improvement in the voice condition that the patient presented with.
Yeah, that's my clinical experience. And it's over and over and over and over, patient after patient. He is an ongoing statistic that I see, where he has tried reflux medication, doesn't work. He has tried speech pathologists who are not specifically trained in voice. And the speech pathologist told him that reflux medication is the way to go. The ear, nose, and throat doctors told him, but he's not getting anywhere, and he can barely talk. So I changed his voice to a clear voice for him within a morning session of about 4 hours.
Is there a difference, in your opinion, and this is for the audience to know, mm-hmm. between a fact and a theory?
Mm-hmm.
What is the current theory today, the medical theory of voice dysfunction related to spasmodic dysphonia?
It's related to reflux acid as a basic cause. Other theories are that it's a basal ganglia problem in the brain, chemical imbalance in the brain. psychiatric care. It's also molecular biological cause. It's this other one we mentioned, reflux, is also called GERD, gastroesophageal reflux disease. They made it a disease. And then there are other theories that come along, but none of the medical theories have ever resulted in a single cure since Stroud first described the condition in 1871.
Now that's a long time ago. Now, if this condition were really due to insanity, and I understand when you were trained back, you know, in the days at UCLA Medical Center and other places, that the patients with spasmodic dysphonia were looked at with sort of a jaundiced eye. Is that true?
Oh, absolutely. They were strange creatures to my colleagues in medicine and to me.
So they did think that they were psychiatrically imbalanced people.
Yes, we were taught to believe in that misconception.
But was that the paradigm, medical paradigm at the time?
Yeah.
Is that spasmodic dysphonia, this strangled voice, was due to a psychiatric problem?
Yeah, it was a mind problem, and these patients were like Hannibal Lecter, liable to reach out and
or bite you or attack you or something.
Attack us and so forth.
Well, when did it finally occur to you that these were normal people with strangled voices?
I mentioned it before. In 1968, a woman had strangled voice, severe spasticity, visited the head and neck division, which I was on the faculty as a clinical assistant professor, and she was sent to me. Spasmodic dysphonia was considered hopeless, and be careful of the patient who had the condition.
And incurable.
Incurable.
But doesn't the medical profession, even today, and we're talking about almost 40 years later, 35 years later, don't they regard this condition as incurable today?
Absolutely. Totally.
And doesn't that fly in the face of what I call the facts?
Yeah.
And there are facts, not just a theory, but there are actually facts. What are the facts?
Well, this young lady with the severe SD back in 68 misunderstood me and raised the pitch of her voice rather than lowered the pitch of her voice, which was the modus operandi. She came back the next week, and she had a perfectly normal voice. I didn't know who she was. We saw so many patients each day. And I checked her record to realize that she had spasmodic dysphonia, and she's talking with a normal voice. It's impossible. And there it was. She had a perfectly normal voice. And I was amazed. I realized that spasmodic dysphonia, the strangled voice, can change. Now, then it was believed to be a psychiatric condition. Today it's believed to be a neurological condition. And they're saying the same thing, that the strangled voice cannot change. You can't get a normal, clear voice. So it does change by placing the voice up in the face, away from the lower throat. I realized that back in 68, and when I left UCLA Medical Center and went into private practice, I carried over that concept. It was an epiphany. Epiphany means basically that it was a eureka moment, a shock.
It's like a revelation to you.
A revelation.
And it was completely unexpected, because you had actually given the patient the wrong
direction.
The wrong
absolutely.
Directions.
Absolutely.
She came back, did not follow your wrong directions, and told you what she did. And
in my mind, she thought she
was supposed to lower the pitch, right?
Yes, right. Amazing moment of truth. And because I was trained in voice.
But it shows you, to some extent, that you, back then, were clueless with respect to how to treat these conditions.
Oh, absolutely.
You fully admit that at one time in your career.
There was nobody who had a single cure. In fact, a fellow by the name of Desso Weiss wrote a book in 1971. He was a psychiatrist in New York City and a famed voice doctor as well, an expert. And he wrote in his book called Functional Dysphonia, that means misused voices, folks. We use big jargon in our field.
But also means non-organic.
Non-organic.
Non-organic voice, right?
It means non-neurological.
It's not neurological. It's not a biological
problem. You're doing something wrong to yourself. Okay. He wrote in his book that anyone making any inroads on this condition, spasmodic dysphonia, any inroads would be making an Olympic achievement. Any inroads. I thought that was a very interesting challenge. I'm turned on by challenge, and I like to question what's going on, what is a fact. The fact is that until 1970, 71, nobody was reporting a cure of the condition. And that 68 incident opened my mind, my eyes, and my awareness that the field of medicine and my field, speech pathology, was on the wrong road. And I changed my idea of the SD patients, spasmodic dysphonic patients, to realize that it wasn't a mind problem. It was a problem of voice placement, a simple voice placement change from the lower throat, where all spasmodic dysphonia today is agreed to be in the lower throat, to the face, where all good and great voices
are. In fact, didn't you work on a study back in the early 1960s that became your doctoral dissertation that indicated that if you can take the voice and change the placement of the voice, then you can actually reverse organic growths on the vocal cords.
Yeah, pre-malignancy. It wasn't just nodes or polyps. Nodes and polyps and contact ulcer were known to be amenable.
And those are organic growths. Those are physical growths on the vocal cords, right?
They're called benign growths. And then you have pre-malignancy growths, which are the next stage is cancer, called papillomatosis, leukoplakia, and keratosis. My biopsy study, biopsied mean they actually verify that this is the condition, papillomatosis, not a node or a polyp or contact ulcer. And I worked on those cases for the dissertation. The study lasted 3 months, worked with them three times a week, every week, and within the period of 3 months, these growths of eight patients involved were reduced or eliminated by direct.
Now, that was quite a revelation, but even at that time, the correlation or the connection to the treatment of spasmodic dystonia was not clear to you at that time. Is that correct?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay. Did not make the connection to SD. You made the connection to these physical growths, these organic growths.
That is absolutely correct.
Okay. Who was the one who drew your connection that the same change in tone, focus, and pitch by raising it out of the lower throat could affect a change in this condition that Dessa Weiss, this famed psychiatrist and voice doctor, said would be a Herculean achievement?
Well, by looking at this woman who had the strangled voice. And you only need one case. You see, if you're trained and your mind is alert to it, the revelation is that we're going in the wrong direction, folks. And I spoke with two people about that case. One is the famed Friedrich Brodnitz of New York, who was instrumental in getting me into the field because I suffered with a bad voice, misdirected by two well-intentioned college professors.
Who told you, in effect, to lower
your voice? Pitch of my voice because I had a nasal thin voice.
What did your voice sound like back then?
I am Mort Cooper, talk like that.
And so that was like a kind of a Brooklyn Bronx-y kind of voice?
Well, it was a typical New York sound. But
not typical of the Upper East Side.
Oh, yes, they talk, the British talk up there. It's a status-oriented thing. I had lived in Britain and I was among the rich and the famous and the lords and so forth, I'd be perfectly fine up there. But I wasn't very persuasive with that voice. These two well-intentioned college professors told me to lower the pitch of my voice. So they didn't have the awareness. They were well-intentioned. And I talk like this. Hi, I'm Mort Cooper. How are you? And it was a great sound. There was tension in the lower throat. And I didn't realize that...
Were you speaking with volume at the time?
Well, I did use volume because I was very shy at the time. And a debate coach, I went after the debate coach, the debate team. And the coach was very, very observant, seeing me have my eyes up in my head and foaming at the mouth and my knees shaking. And he sat back in his swivel chair and he said in his deep voice, "There are only 4 years, Cooper." So I was hopeless. But he helped me to overcome stage fright by sending me to the chorus, which had me sing basso profundo in the lower throat, which added to the tension. He helped me to get stage parts in stage plays, and eventually I got a lead, which I realized my voice is failing, but nobody heard it. And I played, when I was 20 years of age, I was playing a fellow in Both Your Houses who was in his 50s. And that's maturity down here all the way. And it's the lower throat. It's a great sound. People don't realize what it is. And
But I mean, if you didn't use volume, could somebody sustain that deep throat
Henry
voice without blowing their voice out?
Oh yeah, Henry Kissinger. I feel the situation that they have, and he talks like this, and they just use more amplification. And he's just it's kind of he fries his voice, but it's he doesn't push if you listen to him.
So
Irma Bombeck said, if you listen to Henry Kissinger, you miss the first few words, folks. It's all over. He doesn't have that joie de vivre or the sense of outgoing sensibility, and it fits his character.
So it's not a bouncy, enthusiastic voice.
No, it's a very severe voice, and it works for Henry Kissinger, but it didn't work for me. And
what happened to your voice eventually?
Well, it was beginning to show wear and tear, and I was having a lot of problems.
Yeah, I like what you just said, wear and tear.
Yeah.
Because that's the basic theory of one of the great minds of the 20th century. I mean, we know the fellow who single-handedly presented the idea that stress, strain, and wear and tear can break down any organ system in the body and creating a whole host of symptoms.
Mm-hmm.
Not genes, not germs, and not all these mysterious elements that are in the environment, but rather the effect of prolonged and protracted wear and tear can break people down. That is basically what you're saying about the eventual mechanical breakdown of the human voice.
Yeah.
Why is your profession so immune to hearing this simple explanation, which makes perfect sense in every other part of medicine, that they've been open to it and receptive to it? Why did they slam the door in your face?
Well, they didn't prior to the onset of drug companies taking over the treatment of bad, raspy, and strangled voices. The medical profession was quite open to understanding misuse and abuse of the voice, and there's quite a bit of literature in the field. I published that literature in a book called Modern Techniques of Voice Rehabilitation in 73. The medical community was quite aware of the tie-in between voice misuse and abuse and gross on the vocal cord, bad and raspy voices, but they weren't aware, nobody was aware of that leading to the strangled voice. It was considered to be due to a mind problem, psychosocial, whatever attributes you want to put to it. But it was believed to be willful misuse or willful abuse of the voice by the psychiatric.
Now the medical profession believes that the strangled voice is a function or is due to dystonia, which is a neurological condition that involves runaway muscles, renegade muscles that are out of control and spasming.
Yeah, from the basal ganglia, that's a leading theory, from chemical imbalance in
the
brain.
Now, they claim that they have a state-of-the-art, a new treatment for this that's been out for, 7, 8, 9, 10 years now, or maybe even longer, maybe more like 15 years, which is injecting the vocal folds, the musculature of the vocal cords, with Botox. Now, that's a novel approach, and the manufacturer is claiming that that's 99% effective. Now, how can you continue to operate as a voice specialist treating these conditions when all a patient has to do is go down, according to Allergan, get a shot from a reputable ENT man, otolaryngologist, and they're done with it? Mm-hmm. Now, that's what they claim. Now, how is it that you wind up with these patients?
Well, I think the claim is wonderful. I suggest if you have the condition, the strangled voice or a bad and raspy voice, and you're told that Botox, which came into its essence in 1984, brought to the field by Dr. Mitchell Brin back then, who noted the relationship between eye spasms and neck spasms, torticollis, working for Botox, it was believed, and transferring it to strangled vocal cords. Your question again, why do I argue with the field?
If the question is true, why would any patient, if it's 99% effective, why would they go to you?
I understand the question. I'm getting around to the answer. The point is that you have to try it to see if it works. Now, there's a lot of hype and things that we hear day in and day out from different companies, medical procedures and non-medical procedures and so forth. The question is, try it and see. Does it work for you? I hear from the people. I see the people, email, calls, letters, people in person, who prove conclusively from their experience with Botox, having taken 5 shots, 10 shots, 15 shots, 20, 30, 40, 50 shots, it's not working for them. And they're looking for another approach. So I see two groups of people, those who have tried Botox, and I don't oppose it. I said, try it and see if it works for you. It worked for some. The figure of 99%, I think, is quite overblown. I'm not taken with that figure, but it's based on a personal experience, a clinical experience. I'm not privy to know what's going on in each office in this country. I don't find the reports that outgoing because since Botox is an off-label drug or an orphan drug, physicians do not have to report serious side effects and basically don't. So I'm seeing the fallout from Botox in my practice, and it's telling me it's not 99% effective. It's not 90%, it's not 80%, it's not 70, it's not 60, it's not 50. I see it falling off a cliff, but that's from personal experience.
But I mean, effective at what?
Effective at what? Of bringing back the normal voice, they're saying.
But
or stopping
the
spasms.
Patients who have had Botox injections wind up with a Botox-sounding voice?
Which you can describe. What is that Botox-sounding voice? It's
well,
called the Botox voice.
It's called the Botox voice, and it's a voice that really characterizes these unappealing and almost painful kind of strained spasms with a breathiness that is resulting. So they walk in with a form of spasmodic dysphonia, which is called adductor, which is like somebody's choking them or squeezing their throat.
Or abductor.
And then they wind up being induced into abductor.
Which is a breathy.
Which is this breathy sort of breaking up of the voice.
Strangle strain. I can't talk to her.
Yeah.
A breathy voice.
And so that becomes the Botox voice. What's interesting to me is that the medical outcome can be one of relieving spasms, but not necessarily improving the sound or quality or resonance of the human voice.
Well, for a little while, they say, the voice may come back for a short period of time. That's true in some. I've spoken with some who have a good voice for a short period of time. One of the individuals I saw was an MD who said he took a Botox shot every month, and he would have 2 weeks of a normal voice, and then he would have this strangled, strained voice again, or degrading of the Botox shot, where it left him with a... And so he's on a Botox shot for life once every 2 weeks, and I asked him about the long-term concern of his health. He ignored that question. But that's the concern. I don't know if it's effective, and to how many it's effective. That remains outside of my province to judge, but I can tell you from clinical experience that I see the fallout, and it's extensive. Am I seeing only the fallout, or am I not privy to a wider spectrum where Botox is more effective? I can only judge it from my personal clinical practice.
What's interesting is one of your colleagues in the field, Dr. Arne Aronson, that's with two A's, by the way, A-A-R-O-N-S-O-N. Now, he's indicated...
At the Mayo Clinic.
At the Mayo Clinic.
He's retired.
He's indicated that the patients that you treat are psychiatric patients, that these are psychogenic variety. He calls them psychogenic because he believes that the mechanism of action is not neurological. It is, in a sense, psychiatric. Now, are you a competent psychiatrist? Are you somebody who's oriented toward using psychotherapy to help these patients?
No, but he also has... No, absolutely not. But he's also said that my cures, and he acknowledges the cures I have of spasmodic dysphonia, are psychogenic in nature. He adds in writing that the ear, nose, and throat doctors are weeding out the neurological cases, and I'm only seeing the psychogenic cases, or rather just the reverse. I'm seeing How does he say that?
No, he is exactly right. You're exactly right. He's saying that you're winding up, the ear, nose, and throat doctors mm-hmm. are basically sending you their psychogenic cases.
Yeah.
Now, my understanding is that these guys do absolutely no psychological screening at all,
no.
and that many of the cases that you yourself have treated have come from major medical centers,
yeah.
have been diagnosed by MDs, who made no mention whatsoever of psychogenic varieties. As a matter of fact, had a legitimate adductor or abductor spasmodic dysphonia.
Right.
And yet the fact that he's acknowledging that you get a cure is a step in the right direction, in the sense that if you can demonstrate now that these are not psychogenic cases, these are legitimate SD cases, he will have to accept that you do have an effective cure.
Well, the other point is the ear, nose, and throat doctors are not trained in psychiatric care. They don't probe, they don't question, they diagnose. So his position that they're weeding out a certain group of cases, and I'm only seeing psychogenic, he's making them into top psychiatrists.
Which they don't do, because physicians
they're not trained in that.
Are not putting them through any kind of a psychological screening.
No.
What he's assuming is because you're getting results, they cannot be real SD. It must be a psychogenic variety.
Yes, because he's saying neurological, I can't change. But I'm saying it's not neurological.
Now, I spoke
That's
with
the point.
The
we have
Dr.
One
Aronson,
left, yeah.
And he and I mentioned to him that Dr. Mitchell Brin, who introduced Botox to the field in 84, has indicated he doesn't even believe that there are varieties of psychogenic SD.
Right.
He thinks they're all neurological in nature.
Right.
Okay. Now, that's the other question I have. Are you a neurologist?
No.
Are you able to reverse neurological conditions?
Absolutely
then
not.
Then how are you able to get results with patients that
because
are
the
neurologically...
Because the answer is very simple. Spasmodic dysphonia is not a neurological problem from my experience. And it's basically not a psychiatric problem. It's a problem of wrong placement in the lower throat. And that's what I noticed in 68, and that was the moment of truth. And on myself, suffering a voice problem because I was directed to the wrong range and the wrong focus. It was the wrong focus, the lower throat. And it took me a period of time to realize that nearly all voice problems are located in the lower throat, bad and raspy voices, and all strangled voices are in the lower throat. Therefore, they can be changed by voice placement, and that's the key. So there's voice insanity.
So the voice insanity, then, is this one man against the entire world that is saying it's neurological or, as Dr. Aronson says, it's psychiatric.
Well, you judge. Thank you very much, Dr. Curtis. Bye-bye.
Yeah, I think it's fascinating, though, that you know that they that it's the a neurological view or the psychiatric view, and yet 100 years have elapsed and without any real success with psychiatric treatment. Now you've got another 40 years that have gone by with neurological treatment with basically the same results as their great psychiatric cures.
And the point, nobody has a cure in the medical field.
Well,
not one.
But there is somebody who does. There's one person that has a cure for this, and they have a cure because they're basically pointed in the right direction.
But they don't accept cures by me.
No.
That's the issue. And they're not going to accept cures because it doesn't feed their bottom line in the drug industry, in my opinion, and the medical community remains with a paradigm that holds to the fact that spasmodic dysphonia is incurable when, in fact, it has been cured. So make of it what you want. You can call it...